but strictly as an exception, you know, a Jew heroically, tragically confronting the Nazi. As some Jewish friends told me, the point is not that the Jews were not able to do it. The point is that if you portray Auschwitz in this way, you give too much, you concede too much to the Nazis. You diminish the level of the horror that it was going on there. The horror there was so horrible, the terror to the victims, that you were deprived of even the possibility of the space to play this with dignity, this tragic role of a victim. And the same, at a different level, goes also for Stalinist trials. If you look at those horrible scenes, we have some of them on movies, on accused in the Stalinist show trials, confessing. The situation was so terrifying, there was no space for playing the tragic role. The only way to do it is through comedy. But what kind of comedy? Not comedy where you laugh, but comedy where the fact that there is something comic about it makes it, in a way, even more horrible. For example, I read recently, reread, of course, Primo Levi's If This Is a Man. You remember, if you read it, he describes there a scene of so-called selekcja in Polish, because the kapos were Polish, selection. Every month or 2 months, doesn't matter, from all the barracks, the prisoners, they were inspected by an SS doctor, and it was decided, like, do you live or do you die, no? But how was this done? The doctor with the list was sitting behind a table with the list, and you had to run naked in front of the doctor. You were really literally given just 2-3 seconds. And sometimes it even happened, the doctor made the confusion, and then he put you either on one or the other list. You are guests, you can survive. Of course, they learned a couple of days in advance when this selection will take place. And the way Primo Levi, it was in your interest to appear as healthy and strong as possible. So all these small tricks that the prisoners tried to learn, how to pinch your lips to appear not too pale, how to move and so on, and this idea of, now I should run, will he note me or not? I'm sorry to tell you, but there is something not to laugh. Isn't there something almost, I'm tempted to say, comical about it? But of course comical in an extremely tragic way. And I think that here it's not good enough, the movie, Roberto Benigni. Do you know why? Because it's way too humanizing. It avoids the horror. How? The hero played by Benigni is still this kind of a standard trickster, you know, the cunning guy who can survive all the ordeals and so on and so on. And the second thing I don't like is that all the comedy is nonetheless, as it were, sublimated at the end, the last scene, you remember, when his son remembers him. Remember, you are not supposed to laugh, you are supposed to cry. I think that to make Life is Beautiful a truly horrible film, one should change the story a little bit. You know how, not to tell you that, you know the movie probably, the father, so that his son swallows, can survive Auschwitz or whatever, the father tells him the story that this is not really a camp, they are there voluntarily, it's just a kind of a big test, whatever. If they survive without wanting to leave, they will be presented by a prize at the end, blah, blah, blah. Okay. Imagine one complication, that at the end, instead of the father, the son will be dead. This would maybe make it more serious, but for me, the truly traumatic element would have been the following change. Imagine that at the film's end, father, who was again staging a spectacle for the son, pretending, you know, this is just a game, father were to discover that his small son knew all the time the reality. He just feigned to believe the son, to believe his father, to make it less painful to the father. That would make it a much more desperate, the film. I I think something like that should have been done, which is why I much prefer, as a Holocaust movie, did you see Pasqualino Sette Bellezze?
Yeah.
This totally desperate, where you have fun, but at the end, you don't have any redemption. You have just some kind of a total despair, and so on. That's much more up to the point. So again, the lesson here is that tragedy is not tragic to the end of that movie. You know, in tragedy, you are still given a space for this tragic beauty, like Antigone, oh, heroically opposing Creon, no, I was made to die, I prefer to die, and so on, whatever. That's not enough, in a way. Okay, we go on. I would prefer to, you know what? Sorry, please, I'm sorry, yeah, please.
When you say that the carnival is not always liberating.
Yeah. Especially the Brazilian carnival, I think. Yeah, okay.
But do you hold the same analysis for example, storming the Winter Palace in Eisenstein, or the fact that after a protest there might be more laws that will address the protest?
I got your point. What I would have done here, I did it in some of my books, is, of course, one has to squeeze out of this by introducing further distinctions. I don't think that really functions as carnival, and I think you can find a distinction, this distinction clearly in Eisenstein's work itself. You have a murderous carnival there, you know, the famous scene towards the end of Ivan the Terrible Part 2, the only colored, really. There you have the murderous carnival. It is something absolutely breathtaking what Eisenstein does there. He portrays those opriksniks, that is to say, Ivan the Terrible's, the Tsar's, basically secret police, who are dancing almost in a kind of a musical number, a little bit of Kabuki style, a little bit of Hollywood. You know that Eisenstein was consciously imitating even Hollywood there. Eisenstein got this. This is his greatness. So I think that we should distinguish two things. On the one hand, I know what you are referring to. There are this kind of excessive, destructive, liberating violence scenes which you find in early silent Eisenstein. For example, in October, you remember when the sailors break into Winter Palace and in the basement they found glasses of champagne and just break them. Or the most famous case, it would have been his best film. It's unfortunately destroyed. We just have clips. I mean, just not even clips, just photos from Beijing Meadow, that movie where a group of young Komsomols breaks into a church and start to destroy the church. And it's kind of a carnivalesque scene. But I think that this type of violence is to be strictly opposed. And Eisenstein knew this is not the same as the orgy of power, how should I put it? One should draw the difference here. Sorry, any other question before we move onwards here? Because what I want to do is, because yesterday you had some problems, you mentioned that you had enough of, that you had enough of Fritzl, no? So, okay, I propose to skip Fritzl. My only point was that what, I mean, Fritzl, Austria. No, let's skip that. No, what fascinated me?
She's not here.
Sorry?
She's not here.
That person didn't come.
The Austrian.
The Austrian, yes. The Austrian Bhutan girl.
Yeah, she's not here.
She claims she didn't know about
it. She chose not to come.
Sorry?
She chose not to come because you were going to talk about that.
Ah, okay. Then let's go on, okay. No, because what I want to do is talk. I want to spend the rest of the time today precisely elaborating on different modalities on this of this split. Okay, so let me, to finish the first part, go a little bit into the Fritzl domain, where what I was talking about, these two levels of how ideology works, the official public level, explicit rules, and this obscene supplement. The first thing that cannot but strike the eye about this Fritzl affair is that he, Fritzl, the head